Good morning, everybody. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor Vishwaruthi, and he has also joined this meeting. And our librarian Vishwaruthi has also joined this meeting. So may I request our librarian sir to do the introduction of for our speaker. Thank you.
Very good morning to one and all. And at the very outset, let me extend my warm regards and welcome to our today's speaker, and who happens to be one of the noted academicians in manifold, not only in India, also abroad. And currently, we are lucky that we have Professor Bidyut Chakraborty sir as our Vice Chancellor Vishwabharati. And as per the directives of UGC, we are again, on behalf of Vishwabharati Library Network, that university administration is kind enough to allow us to conduct this third national webinar on Gandhiji, which will contain 5 different lectures. Out of that, today is the starting. So I will speak about his topic and on Gandhiji. And you know, since we are living in the pandemic, and Gandhiji, Rabindranath Tagore, they have lots of words and their creation, we found that the pandemic days, how they are passing that, and how they are saying that how to, and guide, rather guide us how to face with this crisis situation and to take a lesson from them to run our present life properly. And actually, Gandhiji, Tagore, Netaji Subhas, they are the great personalities, and their philosophy, their thinking, their principles, their creations is equally compatible in the current day society. So on behalf of Vishwabharati Library Network, in this third national webinar, let me welcome you all the participants, and I'm happy to welcome and inform you all that throughout India, almost 19 states, we are having participants today. And I think today's speech will enlighten us on Gandhiji and to conceptualize Gandhiji through the speech delivered by our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir. And I think with these few words, I may not spare much time. Let us now listen, sir. And before starting speech from our Vice Chancellor, sir, for the audience, let me request you all, please, please and please mute your audio and video to offer a congenial environment so that sir's speech will be listened by everyone properly and which will be recorded properly. And those who are not able to live today's session, don't worry, this session will be recorded and we will upload through our YouTube channel of Vishwabharati Library Network, and that will be available through global level audience. They will listen it from there. And if you have any question, don't put on or unmute your audio. Please post your question in the chat box. 2-3 selective questions we'll take up, and if time permit, sir will be kind enough to deliver answer of your question. So with these few words, let me welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, today's speaker, to deliver his speech. So let me now hand over the floor to our speaker, Vice Chancellor, sir. Sir, let us start your today's session. Thank you, sir.
Vice Chancellor, I'm sure you also agree with me that we are all honorable. And as a matter of fact, I hate being identified as honorable because I am heading a university which is called Vishwabharati, where Tagore used to say, "Mor naam ei bole khyato hok, আমি তোমাদেরই লোক, আমি তোমাদেরই লোক. It means that I would like to be famous not as anybody else, but as one of you. So Dr. Bose, Dr. Saha, Nimai, and Dr. Nimai Saha, I am one of you. So I would be very happy if you introduce me as one of the members of Vishwabharati Poribar. Second, you know, let me begin with two disclaimers. The first disclaimer is that I have been asked to speak in English. To be very frank with you, that's not my language. I mean, we have been doing it because of long colonial hangover, and whenever we speak in English, we translate automatically at the back of our mind. And the translation is done so quickly that we don't seem to understand that it's being translated. The basic point which I am trying to hammer out is the fact that I'm not very good in explaining my ideas in English. And this is the problem of the country as a whole. And I would like to express it with reference to a share written by one unknown poet who died at a very young age. But I think what he wrote in the late 19th century continues to be relevant even today. When you talk of the difficulty in speaking in a language which is not ours, English. He said, Tiktoli aage barke, Tiktoli aage barke, Angreji jaban, Dar hai ke gunga ho jayega Hindustan. It means that, you know, we are very enthusiastic in learning English. But as a result, we have almost forgotten our own mother tongue. And now, those who speak Bangla, who cannot speak in Bangla, we have to speak in a language which is not ours. So we're quite enthusiastic in learning an alien tongue. But today, we are unable to speak to one another in our own language. So that's the kind of, you know, predicament which was stated by one of the early Urdu poets in the late 19th century. The second disclaimer is that, you know, whenever I talk of Gandhi, I have seen in the literature and also in our own perception that we tend to understand Gandhi in worship mode. Hum log puja karte hai. Gandhi has become a god, a demigod. So a demigod needs to be worshipped. A demigod cannot make any mistake. A demigod is one who is always right. So I think, you know, our perception about Gandhi is about a Baba. My understanding is that Gandhi is perhaps the smartest politician human civilization has ever seen. When you talk of politician, you know, I have in mind one basic quality which a politician must possess: the quality of negotiation. Gandhi was perhaps the most effective negotiator born in human civilization. So to me, Gandhi is a human being. Gandhi is one who was trying to understand human civilization in his context and also wanted to change the civilization as per his own priority. What I am trying to argue here, I'm trying to argue that before you understand or before you listen to my speech, you need to relearn yourself. You know, it's just like medicine, that if you take antibiotics without properly certified by medical practitioners, you tend to develop immunity towards that antibiotics. The first thing doctor does is to detoxify you and then doctor applies medicine. Only then it works. I think in intellectual discourse, since we are inundated with so many data, so many interpretations, so many texts, we tend to behave in a particular fashion. So unless and until we de-learn ourselves of what we have learned so far, it is difficult to appreciate what I'm going to talk about. Now, what I am saying so? I am saying so on the basis of an actual historical fact. This de-learning process was identified by none other than Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. If you listen to his last speech in the Constituent Assembly, 25th of November, 1949. There, he began his argument by saying that I am both happy and upset at the same time. Happy because we have been able to articulate the Constitution of India after 3 years of hard work. Upset because I am not sure whether this constitution will survive. Now, when he responded to that question, whether this constitution will survive or not, he referred to one item, which is very noticeable now. He argued that so long as Hindustan talks about Baba, talks about somebody who is infallible, democracy was not likely to succeed. In other words, he was questioning the great man theory. If you have in mind the idea of great man, you tend to think that the great man doesn't make any mistake. And if you tend to think accordingly, then you try to give them as much space as possible. You lose your what is called rational thinking vis-a-vis that great man. He didn't refer to Gandhi, but if you look at that paragraph, you will realize that he was trying to question Gandhi's leadership. As you know, in Indian nationalist movement, three persons never addressed Gandhi as Gandhiji. The first one is Muhammad Ali Jinnah. The second one is Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. And the third one is Churchill. So these three persons never ever addressed Gandhi as Gandhiji. So the point I'm trying to make, you have to understand Gandhi as an individual, who shaped the world, who shaped the Indian nationalist movement in accordance with his own priorities. Now, so the de-learning is very important. That to us, Gandhiji is not a Baba. Gandhiji is not a great man. Gandhiji was just like an ordinary man with flesh and blood. This particular detoxification, this particular de-learning can be explained in terms of Ghalib's small couplet. I'd like to refer to Ghalib's small couplet, and then I'll show that this is what Gandhi meant to us and to the posterity. What did Ghalib say? The first shair which Ghalib wrote, Umar bhar ye gunaha Ghalib karta raha. Umar bhar ye gunaha Ghalib karta raha. Chehra pe dhul tha, aina saaf karta raha. Chehra pe dhul tha, aina saaf karta raha. So, matlab kya hai? What does it mean? It means that, you know, the problem is with you. Problem is not with the mirror. The mirror is clean. You are not clean. So the first thing, as per Ghalib, you have to clean yourself. Only then you can see your clean image, the mirror which is in front of me. So this is a very figurative way of conceptualizing human mind. The second is also very important, which is also applicable to Gandhi. He said, हाथों की लकड़ी पे मत जा गालिब, हाथों की लकड़ी पे मत जा गालिब, नसीब उनका भी होते हैं, नसीब उनका भी होते हैं जिनका हाथ नहीं होते. Now we try to understand our fate in terms of the lines in our hands. But suppose if I didn't have a hand, it means that I didn't have any, you know, what is called future. So Ghalib argued that, you know, human future can be built. Human future can be taken into a particular course of action. Human future can be undertaken in a particular way by dint of one's endeavor, one's effort. So effort-driven activity. This is what Gandhi was. For Gandhi, he said, you know, I don't have any message. My life is my message. So he organizes his life in such a way which articulated certain ideas about humanity, certain ideas about human civilization, certain ideas about human activity. So Gandhiji did not put forward one particular theoretical framework. On the contrary, we can call out his theories on the basis of activity. Now, how do I go about it? As you know, Gandhi wrote enormously. And if you have any idea, you go and see the collected works which Gandhi produced, we have got 100 volumes. And each volume has got 800 pages. Each page has got 400 words. So count them. If I ask you to just simply, you know, write it down, simply copy Gandhian text, I think you will spend all your life. And at that point of time, when there was no computer, and Gandhi was the one who traveled all the time, and the fastest mode of travel at that point of time was railway. Yet he could write so much. But I would like to draw your attention to two books, two full-length books, and two booklets. If you look at Gandhi's text, besides his memorandum, besides the letters, besides his speeches, he wrote only two books and two booklets. Two books, his autobiography, which he wrote in 1923. He wrote his movement book, that's known as Satyagraha in South Africa. He wrote Hind Swaraj, that's 1909, and he wrote Key to Hell. So these are the four texts which he wrote in order to write books. And the rest, what you see in the collected works, are all his speeches, all his writing, all his, you know, what's called texts, which he wrote in response to his speeches, etc., etc. So when you think of Gandhiji's writing, we'll have to keep it in mind what he wrote in totality. Now it's difficult to, you know, give you an idea of totality because of the paucity of time, but I just identify certain what is called important features. But to me, Gandhiji is not an individual. When you think of Gandhi, we think in terms of two important categories. The first category is historical Gandhi. Gandhi was born in 1869 and was killed in 1948. That's historical Gandhi. But I'm not interested in historical Gandhi, because Gandhi died in 1948, and today, in 2020, we are still talking about Gandhi, which means he is transcendental. So I'm interested to understand the realizational Gandhi. Gandhi was relevant in the context of 20th century, Gandhi, which is relevant even in today's context. So I would like to approach the question as to why is Gandhi relevant even today? Why are you talking about Gandhi? So he must have left certain things, certain ideas to us, which made us think afresh. Now I'll begin with a story. 1901, quite so famous, because 1901, the Congress Party held its annual session in Calcutta. Gandhiji was not here, he was in South Africa. But he wanted to participate in this Congress, so he came to Calcutta and wanted to be part of that annual meeting of the Indian National Congress. And all the delegates kept in different buildings. And in one of the buildings, Gandhi stayed. In the morning, Gandhi found out that there was a huge gathering in front of the toilet. So Gandhi was a little curious. So he went inside and he found the toilets were filthy. So nobody was willing to go in. And then what he did, he collected one jhadu, one broom, and one bucket, one balti. Then he took them inside. He cleaned all the toilets himself, came out, said, now you can go and use it. Gokhale was there. Gokhale was surprised. He asked, who is this gentleman? He said, he is Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, who came from South Africa. So now, why am I telling this story? Now, this story is famous because Dinsa Wacha was the chairman of that particular congress. And Dinsa Wacha also referred to this in his speech to the congress. So why am I telling this story? I'm telling this story that here is a man who didn't bother whether this particular job was to be done by him or not. But he knew that once that job was particularly done, people could use the toilet. So he didn't bother about whether their particular job was befitting of him or not. He did it. So to me, this particular example shows that Gandhiji was a man of action. Gandhiji was not a man of precepts. Gandhiji was a man of deed. And from this, I argue, and I am convinced also, that to me, Gandhiji is not a human being. Gandhiji is nothing but a creative blending of many qualities. Hence, to me, Gandhiji is an acronym. Gandhi is an acronym, and I define this acronym in terms of this. G for gentle. G stands for gentleness. A stands for attentive. Look, you know, he went inside and cleaned the toilet, so he was attentive to the problem. N, negotiating. He was constantly negotiating. I mean, the entire independence movement, if you look at the way Gandhi functioned, Gandhi was basically a negotiator with the British court, with his colleagues, with his detractors, those who criticized Gandhi, So Gandhi was a negotiator par excellence. So to me, N stands for negotiating. He stands for diligence. He was the one who always worked hard. You know, Gandhiji used to get up 4 o'clock in the morning, and you know that when he was not unwell, he used to wash his clothes. He used to have only 4 dhotis, and every day he used to wash 2 dhotis himself. So he was a hardworking person, age humble. He never expressed that he was Gandhi, so he was away from the people. That's why I told Nimai that in the idea of honorable is nothing but an attempt to alienate the speaker. So Gandhi was the one who was so humble, he never wanted to be alienated. And then finally, inquisitive. He was very curious. If you look at his ideological position, you will find that he was always curious. He wanted to know. And from this, I would like to raise 3 questions, which to me, Karamchand Gandhi. Question is very simple. And it's also simple that somebody may argue Gandhi emerged because it was India which believed in non-violence, which is the place where Vaishnavism was born, where Jainism was born, where the British government imposed certain restrictions to carry even simple knives. So at that point of time, probably Gandhi became Gandhi because Gandhi was the one who popularized the idea of non-violence. So why was Gandhi was still a relatively easier question to respond to. But what was Gandhi? That's the question which troubles everybody. Those who deal with Gandhiji, those who deal with civilizational Gandhi, they get humble. What was Gandhi? What was Gandhi? Now here, I am trying to understand Gandhi from my point of view. And then I'll elaborate these 3 points. As I said, following Baba Sahib Ambedkar, I do not consider Gandhi to be a Baba. I do not consider Gandhi to be a great man. I consider Gandhi to be a smart politician with extraordinary qualities. An ordinary man like us, an ordinary mortal human being. But he became Gandhi simply because he possessed extraordinary qualities. That's one. Secondly, as I said at the beginning, Gandhi's appeal continues to remain relevant even in the context of 21st century, if not later. At least today, into 2020, we are sitting together, and there are many who are attending this webinar. They appear to be interested to know more about Gandhi. That's why they are registered. So Gandhi, to me, is transcendental in appeal and spirit. By transcendental, I mean Gandhi was not relevant to the period he was working, 1869 to 1941. Gandhi is still relevant. So transcendental in terms of age. He's transcendental in terms of space. He was born in India, yet when you have Arab Spring, you know, the Muslim Brotherhood referred to Gandhi. When there was civil rights movement in the United States under Martin Luther King Jr., you talk about, they talked about Gandhi. When there is struggle against apartheid in South Africa, they talk about Gandhi. So, you know, the point I'm trying to make, that Gandhi was transcendental. He was born in a particular age, yet he remains relevant beyond that age. He was born in a particular space, yet he continues to remain effective elsewhere. The third point, Gandhi is a Mahatma without being self-centric. Now, as you know, the Mahatma is a Sanskrit word, which means a soul which is great, a great soul. Now, he's a great soul, but he never ever talk about himself. If you look at his writings, you'll hardly find any reference where he talked about himself. He wrote his autobiography. That's nothing but how Gandhi evolved as Gandhi till age of 63. And we don't know what happened afterwards. You will find out from his writings, from different sources. So to me, Gandhi remained a great soul without thinking about himself. So these three important hypotheses, these are hypotheses, simply to take you further, to take you into the, what is called, you know, the mess, which I am going to fill in course of time. When the question comes, how was he conceptualized? I would like to take you to history. And how was he conceptualized by those who interacted with him, who dealt with him, who saw him, who knew him? So the first example, as far as I am concerned, happens to be John Smuts of South Africa. He was the ruler in South Africa. And as you know, Gandhi went to South Africa in search of a job. He was sent to South Africa with a job because he was a briefless lawyer in Bombay. So he went to South Africa in Durban with a brief, with a legal case. And the moment he went, that was in 1894, and he came back in 1914. So roughly, you know, 21 years he was in South Africa. And in these 21 years, he became Mahatma. And that's why there is a famous sentence by John Smuts saying, "You gave us Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, I gave you the Mahatma." Now, John Smuts, how did he conceptualize Gandhi? Because Gandhi was enemy. Gandhi was John Smuts' enemy. You know, he led many movements in South Africa. If I had time, I could have elaborated, but the time is running out. So John Smuts was enemy number one. So, you know, have the understanding of the relationship between John Smart and Gandhi. They were not friends, but they were foes, they were enemies. So how did John Smart, who was the ruler of South Africa then, visualized, approached, comprehended Gandhi? I'll quote. "It was my fate," according to John Smart, "it was my fate to be antagonist of a man for whom I had the greatest respect. It was my fate to be antagonist of a man for whom I had greatest respect. I must frankly admit that his activities at that time were very trying to me, because Gandhi raised a troublesome issue. This particular statement was made in 1914, when Gandhi was about to leave for India. Now, if you analyze this statement, you know, there are two important levels at which this argument can be pitched. The first level, that he was overall an enemy of Gandhiji. He said, you know, I was antagonistic. I was always antagonistic because I was the ruler and he was the one who was trying to question my administration. So I was always enemy. But at the same time, he also said, I had greatest respect for the man. Because he knew, you know, if you look at his autobiography or memoirs, you'll find that he realized that the issues which Gandhiji raised at that point of time were genuinely pro-human beings. So at the heart of heart, John Smart realized that Gandhiji was raising those issues which you'd have understood had he not been the ruler. So as a ruler, you know, he had constraints. As a ruler, he was not appreciating the ideas left by Gandhi. But as a human being, he understood. He realized that Gandhiji was making those issues which are essentially humanistic. And you know, if you look at the history, Satyagraha in South Africa, you'll find that the issues which Gandhiji raised was not only about the indentured laborers, Indian laborers in South Africa, it was all about those who are marginalized, those who are downtrodden, those who were exploited. So I think as a human being, John Smart realized, but couldn't do much simply because he had also an agenda as an administrator. And those who work in administration, they will appreciate what I'm saying. I mean, I also undergo the same kind of thing. So, you know, this is quite natural. So the point I'm making here, if you look at the first stated expression about Gandhi, according to Smart, he conceptualized Gandhi as a way of life. A way of life which was humanistic. A way of life which was for human beings. A way of life which was for the marginalized. So then I'll take you to 1918. Now 1918, Champaran. You know that Champaran made Gandhi famous. And Gandhi, known to Indians in general, simply because of his involvement in Satyagraha in Champaran in 1918. Now, here also I got a memoirs of the district magistrate of Champaran, 1918. A young Scottish guy, he was 24 years old. He was district magistrate of Champaran. When Gandhi was to come to Champaran by rail, he was asked to be in the station to see and report to his bosses. So this guy brought friars, came to the station, and he was surprised that it was not a station. It was just ocean of human beings. He was surprised. Who is this gentleman coming? And this ocean of human beings are there to receive him? He was surprised. You know, a young Scottish guy, he couldn't believe that this could be possible. So this guy said, after, you know, he returned, after Gandhi descended from the compartment, he was encircled. He couldn't see Gandhi. But he realized that there was a gentleman who came out of the compartment, and then he was not visible in the ocean of humanity. So he was writing to his boss, saying that, you know, I realized one thing. So I was young, I was just 23 years old, that to the masses, he is a liberator. To the masses, he is a liberator, because he is transfiguring, the imagination of the masses. He said, you know, why did people come? He must have talked to people. He must have gathered their views. And he said, when I talked to the people, I realized that here is a man who is coming, who will give them liberation against the indigo planters. You know that Champaran took place against the ruthless indigo planters in Kathia system. That you have to, if you have got, you know, one big land, you have to grow indigo in 1/3 of the land in Kathia system. And indigo at that point of time has to be sold to the Britishers at their price. So the cultivator didn't get what they wanted. Plus, cultivator also couldn't get their foodstuff. So cultivator had to go hungry. So it happened because of that. Gandhiji came. And you know, at that point of time, Rajendra Prasad was the one who organized the movement. But the moment Gandhiji came, the movement took a different dimension. So there is a debate going on that had there been no Rajendra Prasad, do you think movement would have taken place? You know, it's just chicken egg controversy. I don't know the reason. I don't know the answer. But the point I'm trying to make, that Rajendra Prasad, along with Gandhi, took part in this particular campaign and stopped, to a significant extent, is in Kathia production. But see, the realization of the district magistrate, that's the story we know. That's a story what happened afterwards. But this gentleman, young gentleman, Lord Friars, he realized then that here is a man who was a liberator as far as common human beings are concerned. For the common human being, Gandhiji was recognized as one who had the potential of bringing about liberation for them. So this is how he conceptualized Gandhi. Then comes 1921. Lord Reading was the Viceroy of India at that point of time, 1921, just during the non-cooperation movement. And Gandhiji was asked to see him. Very interesting story. Those who saw Rashtrapati Bhavan, that was the residence of the Governor General. So Lord Reading gave him an appointment. He went, and you know, given his dress code, you know, his simple dress, he was stopped at the gate by the chowkidar. Saying, "Where are you going?" He told, "You know, I have got an appointment with Lord Reading." Probably today he would not have been allowed to get in, but see, since it was 1921, people didn't have that kind of apprehension. So people allowed him to come and go in. He went, and then he came to the door of the office of Lord Reading. The doorkeeper, chowkidar there, stopped him. Where are you going? He said, I have an appointment with the Lord. He was allowed to go in. And then Lord was doing something. You know, I got it from his memoirs, Lord Reading's memoirs. The Lord was doing something without paying any attention to his surroundings. So he didn't notice Gandhi. And Gandhi was very short figure. So if he moves around, you cannot notice it. He was standing there, and then suddenly he saw. He said, "Who are you?" He said, "I am Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. I came here to see you because you gave an appointment." "Okay, sit down." And then there was discussion going on. The interesting point I'm going to highlight now. He had discussion with him on various issues regarding a non-cooperation movement. And then he wrote in his memoirs, there was nothing striking about his appearance. Notice the words. There was nothing striking about his appearance. But when he talks, the impression was different. This is the statement made by Lord Reading, who ruled India in the 1921-1923. Now, what does it mean? It means the point which I made at the outset, that here is a person who could talk to the British in their language, in their ideological discourse, and at the same time had the authority, had the potential to persuade them. That Gandhi was a great negotiator. That Gandhi was the one who could persuade people, who could mold people to his views, is very evident from this particular statement by Lord Reading. Now, these are the views which I have drawn from those who considered Gandhi to be enemy. Whether you talk of John Smarts, whether you talk of the district magistrate of Champaran, whether you talk of Lord Reading. You know, the relationship between them is a relationship between enemies, two enemies. One who was trying to sustain India as a colony, another was trying to take India out of colonialism and make India free. So the relationship was imbalanced. Now I'll bring you to those who appreciated Gandhi yet couldn't understand. What was he? So the point I keep hammering, that when you think of conceptualizing Gandhi, you are, you know, being constantly facing hurdles. There is no straightforward line. There is not a particular discourse which can be applied to Gandhi, and you can say, well, Gandhi means enlightened thinker, Gandhi means Marxist thinker, Gandhi means liberal thinker. To me, Gandhi means Gandhi thinker. So now I'll show you the comments made by those who appreciated Gandhi and tried to understand Gandhi. Why did he become Gandhi? Why did he become so popular? Why did he put forward a point of view which never thought before Gandhi was born? I'll begin with Romarola. You know, Romarola is the one, a French literature person who got Nobel Prize in 1915, just before after Tagore. He's the one who wrote the first, George Duque wrote in 1910, Gandhi's biography. But George Duque's biography was not known to the rest of the world. But Romarola wrote Gandhi's biography in 1924, which is very popular, which is universally known. In this particular biography, he wrote, I'm quoting, this is the man who stirred 300 million people to revolt. 300 million means 30 crore. 30 crore people to revolt, who has shaken, this is the man who has shaken the foundation of British Empire and who has introduced into human politics the strongest religious impetus of the last 2000 years. The last part is very important. You know, Romarola was a devout Christian. The last part, who introduced into human beings the strongest religious impetus of the last 2000 years. What are those? One, infinite patience, and two, infinite love. So Gandhi became Gandhi simply because he popularized these two ideas of humanity, which are there in human history, but we forgot. It is Gandhi who revived that tradition. And if you believe his, if you, you know, see Gandhi's strategy is based on infinite patience and infinite love. If you look at Christian ethics is based on infinite patience and infinite love. So Romarola said that Gandhi is most distinctive simply because he reminded us of our tradition, of the tradition of humanity. The tradition of humanity, which is based on the values, the morals of thousands of years old. And these two things are infinite patience and infinite love. So the British Empire was shaken simply because it was the humanity which rose against the British Empire, which rose against the British ruthlessness on the basis of infinite love and infinite patience. So here, a friend of Gandhi, who wrote in a very superlative way, in a very supportive way, by saying that Gandhi is not very unique. Gandhi actually reminded us of our past tradition, the tradition in which we appreciated infinite love and infinite patience, which are the foundation of Christian ethics, Romarola. Then we come to Einstein. He wrote this once he was assassinated in 1948. He made a very perceptive comment. He said, generations to come will scarce believe that such a one as this, means Gandhi, walked the earth in flesh and blood. He said, you know, Gandhi did something remarkable, did something unthinkable, that he fought the mightiest empire of the 20th century, the British Empire, without any weapon, without any, you know, soldier. He fought them by infinite love and infinite care. Now, here he argues that, you know, Europeans talk about enlightened values. What does it mean? It means three things, three C's. When you talk about enlightenment, we are confronted with three ideals, which I call three C's: care, concern, and compassion. Care, concern, and compassion. So I still argue, see, these are the things we talk about. We say we are liberal thinker, simply because liberalism is based on the philosophy of enlightenment. Whether you talk of Hobbes, whether you talk of Locke, whether you talk of Rousseau, whether you talk of Bentham, whether you talk of, you know, Kant, anybody, any of the European thinkers, all are enamored by the idea of enlightenment, which means three C's: concern, care, and compassion. But when it comes to India, British government is not following enlightened values. They forgot. They are most uncaring. They do not have concern for the Indians, and they do not have compassion for Indians. But this man, Gandhiji, is the one who nurtured these values in such a way so that British Empire got shaken. British Empire had to leave. So in future, if I say that the mightiest empire became most fragile simply because of compassion, care, concern, people may not believe it. So this is his observation. So what does it mean? How did he conceptualize? For him, Gandhiji is unthinkable. So Gandhiji became Gandhiji on the basis of the values which Europeans also propagated, enlightened values. So this is Albert Einstein. Now I'll come to Martin Luther King. I'm coming, Albert Einstein 1948, now I'm coming to the 1960s, civil rights movement. As you know, Martin Luther King Jr. did not know much about Gandhi when he started his civil rights movement. But his professor introduced him to the Gandhian ideas through books. And he said that I was doing a coursework with a professor, with my professor, and suddenly he said about Gandhi. I went out, I bought the book, and I found out it's jewel for me. And what did he learn? And then, you know, he utilized Gandhian ideas, whether you talk of Montgomery bus drive, whether you talk of Birmingham March, whether you talk of his speech in Washington, D.C., there he's talking about Gandhi continuously. That means he was persuaded to believe that in order to make Americans understand that the blacks or African Americans are as much Americans as the white Americans, you cannot fight them by weapons. You have to fight them non-violently. And for that, you have got a model, Gandhiji. So he read Gandhian text, and he came in 1964, I think, 64. And then in 69, he was killed. So, and then he went to Rajghat, etc. But the point I'm trying to make, what did he say? He said, as I read Gandhiji's text, I became deeply fascinated by his campaigns of non-violent resistance. As I delve deeper into the philosophy of Gandhi, my skepticism concerning the power of love gradually diminished. And I came to see for the first time its potency in the area of social reform. Okay, two ideas are prominent here. Again, it's based on Christian ethics. If you look at Martin Luther King Jr.'s philosophy, it's largely based on Christian ethics. And it was easier for him to mobilize his support simply because all the African Americans were Christian. And he was himself, as you know, himself was a pastor. He was a church father, priest. Here, I think two points are important, which he did not realize. It was there in Christian ethics. So if you look at the Sermon on the Mount, that if you slap on one lap, one cheek, I'll give you another cheek to slap me. This is Sermon on the Mount. But this is what is called, you know, physical. But what does it metaphorically mean? To me, it means two things. First, as far as Martin Luther King Jr. is concerned, A, love is an instrument of change. Love is an instrument of change. And secondly, it's a source of power in the sense that it transforms others' behavior. Now, you know, this is Gandhian. This primarily Gandhian, Gandhi say, what Gandhi say? That by pain, I win my enemy over. By torture, by using, by, you know, absorbing torture happily, I'll win my enemy over. That means what? That even if you torture me, even if you kill me, even if you slap me, even if you put me in the jail and ask me to undergo all kinds of torture, I will have no enmity vis-a-vis you. Means what? Love. Pure love. I don't have any hatred for enemy. I have love for it. And as a result, in course of time, I'm sure you will change your behavior. It happens. If you look at your own behavior, it happens. But again, I'm trying to argue here that this is nothing new. You know, don't think Gandhiji brought out a unique formulation. No. Gandhiji simply reiterated what was there. It is very much part and parcel of the Christian ethics, the New Testament. If you look at New Testament, chapter number 5, John is talking about this Sermon on the Mount. John himself is Jesus. So New Testament, you know, Martin Luther King Jr. talks about New Testament again and again. There is also a catch here. New Testament does not talk about slavery, while Old Testament talks about slavery. So if you look at Martin Luther King's own text, you'll hardly find any reference to the Old Testament simply because it talks about slavery. So the point I'm trying to make that you see here, there are two widely considered human beings who are global. They think alike. Their source of thinking alike is different, but conceptually they are similar. Because Christianity, the New Testament, is pretty old. And Gandhiji used to read New Testament pretty often. Gandhiji has a very, you know, very unique habit of reading stuff, whatever he got. So from that, Gandhi might have been influenced by this idea. And when Martin Luther King talks about this, that love can be transformative. Love can bring about change. This is something which Gandhi proved before he started civil rights movement in 1960s. So from Gandhi, he borrowed these two important ideas, is love as an instrument of change and love is transformative. And again, let me reinforce the point that Gandhiji did not develop or did not invent these ideas. He borrowed these ideas probably from Buddhism, probably from Jainism, which were similar to that of Christian ethics. That's why Martin Luther King Jr. and Gandhiji fought alike and led a movement against, again, America is a very ruthless state, led a movement successfully and got right to franchise for the African Americans in 1965. So success. Success on the basis of nonviolent revolution, which is both Gandhian and also drawn on Christian ethics. But the objective, the goal, the mission is similar. And if you look at the theoretical roots of their conceptualization, that's also similar. Right? So his conceptualization of Gandhi is based on his understanding of Christian ethics. Gandhi may have got from New Testament, because he used to read a lot, or he may have got from Buddhism, Jainism, which also talks about nonviolence. Then comes Nelson Mandela. So Nelson Mandela, in my time, 10 minutes, I'll finish in 10 minutes. Nelson Mandela. Now Mandela, as you know, he was also an activist. He was the one who was in jail for 27 years. And he was the one who led South Africa away from apartheid regime by leading a movement which was primarily nonviolent. I'm saying primarily because there are also violent incidents as far as Zulu killing is concerned. Now, again, I'd like to, you know, make a kind of, you know, observation or make a disclaimer, because if you look at Nelson Mandela's autobiography, you will not find very appreciative tone of Mandela vis-a-vis Gandhi, which probably you'll find in Martin Luther King Jr. Perhaps when Gandhi was in South Africa, Gandhi had some racial prejudices. You know, if I had time, I'll talk about it. And, you know, that's one of the reasons why there is a statue in front of Ghana University. And that particular statue had to be removed because Gandhi was identified as a racist guy. Anyway, that's a different point altogether. I'm not coming. That was the reason as why you don't find many appreciative, you know, comment by Mandela on Gandhi. Nonetheless, Mandela also talks about Gandhi. And here, to him, as I said, Gandhi was not a Baba. Gandhi was not a philosopher king. Gandhi was not a religious dictum. Gandhi was essentially a human being who devised a strategy of nonviolence. Mandela used the word strategy. He said in the context of India then, nonviolence was essentially a strategy to mobilize maximum number of people. So here, he was perhaps referring to Gandhiji being a politician. So a politician, you know, resorts to different strategies. And you don't know which strategy will work at what point of time. So Mandela was impressed by Gandhiji simply because of these grand ideas, which we talked about earlier, but because he was the one who devised a perfect strategy at that point of time, and he appreciated Gandhi simply because He was the one who generated enthusiasm, mass enthusiasm for this kind of strategy. So he was a perfect politician. He was the perfect political leader. A leader who understood politics better than anybody else. A leader who understood which strategy will work at what point of time. That's why he became Gandhi. That's why we are even talking about. So Mandela, unlike Martin Luther King or Rama Rolla, did not talk about the ethical aspect at all. Here, he was approaching Gandhi essentially as an activist, as a political activist. But he made two interesting points, for which I think I appreciate Mandela, that he said, nonetheless, that he devised a very effective strategy. Nonetheless, he developed two important points which are very useful conceptually in today's context. As you know, he was not very pro-Marxism. He argues that Gandhiji was the one who questioned Marxism by devising his notion of trusteeship. What is trusteeship? He said, you know, God identified some of us as trustees of wealth. They are the one who can maintain that wealth. That's why there is Tata, that's why there is Birla, that's why there is Goenka. And these people are chosen by God that they maintain their wealth and they will distribute their wealth for the well-being of humanity as a whole. Now, you may not agree with it. On the surface, it is most illogical. Because if you have more, you'd like to have more. But if you have morality, Gandhi's philosophy is based on morality. If you approach this point of view from morality, it makes sense. Mandela argues that, see, at this point of time, when there is class rivalry, Russian Revolution, Chinese Revolution going on, everybody is talking about class struggle. Everybody is talking about antagonism between rich and the poor. At this point of time, Gandhi popularized the idea of trusteeship. That is what? He devised a powerful critique of Marxism. So, despite not being persuaded by Gandhi, Mandela appreciated Gandhi's critique of Marxism. And secondly, he said he was the one who also suggested production. He also talked about specific kind of production. What did he suggest? He always talks about not mass production. He talks about production by the masses. Production by the masses. What does it mean? It means that you devise a system, handicrafts. You know, Shantiniketan is a good example. Tagore, Rabindranath Tagore, you know, implemented that into practice. Tagore believed that if you pay money to a poor, he or she will spend that money. And then he becomes poor after a week or 10 days or a month. But if you give them skill, you or she will survive. So that means, you know, you involve them in production. You know, weaving is something in which you need a lot of people. Blacksmith, carpentry. So Gandhiji wanted to devise a system of production in which mass participates. So Mandela argues that, see, when we are thinking in terms of automation, we're thinking of computerization, when you think of, you know, less manpower and more production so that you can make more profit, Gandhiji is the one who devised production by the masses. That's most important. So this is Mandela. Now I would like to conclude. What is Gandhi now? I don't know whether those who are listening to me and those who are here have any idea. Gandhiji, to me, is a chameleon. It is multi-dimensional. If you look at Gandhi from the point of view of his work in South Africa, you will understand one Gandhi. If you look at Gandhi in the context of India, you will find another. If you look at Gandhi in the context of 1942, you will find another. If you look at Gandhi in terms of Shotish Dasgupta, you will find one Gandhi. If you look at Gandhi in terms of Baba Ramachandra in Meerut, you will find one Gandhi. If you find Gandhi in terms of Profulla Sen, you will find another Gandhi. If you look at Gandhi in terms of Anilboron Rai of Arambag, you will find one Gandhi. If you look at Asrapati Ramek Chaudhary of Borishal, you will find one Gandhi. So what I am trying to argue that there are many Gandhi. There is not one. There are many Gandhis. And these many Gandhis are conceptualized differently. It depends on your theoretical yardstick, on your approach. So the question which I set out at the outset, what is Gandhi? We don't have any specific answer. But we can draw certain conclusions which will help us to take this kind of research forward. Because I strongly believe that whatever thinking I put forward is not simply for 1 hour leisurely listening. It's also a kind of, you know, I would say an innovative design to look at Gandhi or Gandhian ideas, or for that matter, anybody's ideas are fresh. So I'd like to make three important points as concluding observations. The first, since there is no specific answer in social sciences, because human mind is very fickle, the answer needs to be found out. Answer needs to be made defensible. Answers need to be made persuasive. How will you do that? I have got a formula. You may not agree, but this is the formula I put forward. The first thing, life, for that matter, anybody's life. I'm not talking about Gandhi. I'm talking about X, Y, Z. Life is the outcome of interaction with the context and individuals. Life is the outcome of dialectical interaction with the context and the individual. What do I mean? I strongly believe that Gandhiji would not have become Gandhiji had he not been critiqued by Rabindranath Tagore, by B.R. Ambedkar, by M.A. Jinnah. Gandhi had illustrious colleagues who put forward a completely different point of view. You know, Gandhi's humanism would not have been there without Rabindranath being there. Gandhi's concern for social justice would not have become so sharp had Baba Saheb Ambedkar not around. Gandhiji's idea of accommodating religious differences would not have been so candid had M.A. Jinnah not been around. So individuals are very important. That's true everywhere. And the context. The context is very important. You know, Muslims are becoming very powerful from 1906 onwards. That's why Khilafat, Muslims, Hindus, were considered to be two separate communities. Lucknow Pact, 1916, Muslims were considered separate from the Hindus. Bengal Pact, C.R. Das, 1924, Muslims, Hindus were considered separate. Here is Tagore is different. Tagore said, you cannot make them different because we are born, nurtured, raised in the same environment. How can we be different? We nurture the same mindset. The Hindus in a particular village or Muslims in that particular village, they cannot be different. That's what Tagore's point of view, that they are born and nurtured by the same mindset. So how can you say, separate them? Gandhiji considered them separate. And that's why probably that is one of the reasons Jinnah became so strong, and 1940 Lahore resolution is the outcome. So anyway, that's the historical conjecture. So context and individual. The second point, so we are not independent of the context of the individual. You know, I am influenced by the librarian Nimai. I'm influenced by my colleagues sitting there. I'm influenced by my colleagues sitting here. And my influence varies from person to person. Now, there is a general saying that a child is influenced more by his or her mother when he or she is young. When he or she grows older, especially after teenage, he or she is very close to his or her father. Now, when you think of Gandhiji, when you think of Martin Luther King Jr., when you think of anybody else, the big names, their influence comes from different sources and in different forms. Source and forms are different. Forget about Gandhiji's parents. But Gandhiji, you know, if I had time, I would have elaborated who are the people who influenced Gandhi more. But I'm just giving the names. The first influence comes from mentor. Gandhiji would not have become Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi had not his parents taken ample care when he was young. Right? So mentor. Gandhiji would not have become Gandhi had Gokhale not been around. Gokhale was the one who identified. When he went to South Africa, he told Gandhi that this is not the place for you. You have to come to India. So Gokhale. So mentor. There are intellectual mentors, there are physical mentors. Intellectual mentor, Tolstoy. Tolstoy was the one who influenced Gandhi tremendously. John D. Ruskin, intellectual ideas. He got it from John D. Ruskin. Thoreau, Henry David Thoreau. The idea of Satyagraha is something which comes from Henry David Thoreau. If at time I could have elaborated all of them. Edward Carpenter, Gandhi's Hind Swaraj was based on Edward Carpenter's 1882 book, Civilization and Its Crisis. So intellectually, there are many mentors. Physically, his wife, Kasturba. Without Ba being there, Gandhi would not have become Gandhi. So mentor is one source of influence and also one form of influence. And mentor can be both physical and ideological. Then second, we have got soulmate. You know, Gandhiji would not have become Gandhi had he not been in touch with C.F. Andrews. C.F. Andrews was the one who understood Gandhi better than anybody else. And C.F. Andrews is the one who talked about Tagore to Gandhiji. C.F. Andrews is the one who influenced, who persuaded Gandhi to come to Shantiniketan. So Kallenbach, Richard Kallenbach, is another soulmate. I mean, the people talk many interesting, juicy story about the relationship. But it was he who made Gandhi as a person of multitasking abilities, Kallenbach. So, soulmate. Then we have got fellow travelers. There are a lot of people who traveled with him, who influenced Gandhi to become Gandhi, and who also carried forth Gandhian tradition. Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel, Rajagopalachari, Badshah Khan. You know, they are the people who are fellow travelers. They traveled with Gandhi, yet they carried forward the Gandhian ideas. Right? And then finally, disciple. Mirabai. Mirabai is the one who really made Gandhi to a significant extent. You know, in 1939-40, Gandhi would have died because of tuberculosis had Mirabai not around. Mirabai persuaded him to shift from a mud house to a concrete house, because mud house was very cold and Gandhi had pleurisy. A doctor advised him to shift, and he said, no, I don't want to shift here. I'd like to stay here. There is a chatai, amader shitol pati jeta boli. And then Gandhi used to lie down on that. And it was Mirabai who forced Gandhi to go to another building, which was concrete made. And he used to have the Rajai after that. So disciple. So the point I am trying to make, that Gandhiji became Gandhiji because of influence of these four different sources and mentors. And then finally, there are certain tipping points, triggering factor. And that triggering factor creates a new ideological perception. I don't have time, so I'll just give you one example. There are many examples. I'll give you a very known example. 1942, Gandhi became less Gandhian. Gandhi became non-Gandhian. So Gandhi allowed people to come out and face the British with whatever weapon you have at your possession. This is not Gandhi. Gandhi is talking about weapon. So far he hated, he detested. Just before 42-39, he wrote a letter to Hitler, questioning Hitler, you know, like anything. So this Gandhi, all of a sudden, talk about weapon in 1942. Simply because he realized that this British government probably would not listen to non-violent language. So he said, "Hum rahe na rahe, hum karenge ya marenge." That's the statement, last statement he said. He was incarcerated, he was jailed. So at that's a tipping point to me. That's a triggering factor, which allowed Gandhi to explore the possibility of being violent on occasions. And Gandhi defended and said, you know, if I am asked to make a choice between cowardice and violence, I'll go for violence. In 1946, he came to Mahishadal. And you know, Mahishadal, there's a what is called provisional government, which continued for 3 years. 42-45, and they surrendered only when Gandhi came. Sushil Dhara, Satish Samanta, these are people. And Gandhi said that, you know, I know that there are many British policemen, not Pirangi, Indian policemen, who raped Indian women. And at that point of time, if you kill the British police, I would have supported. I support you, because that's the best option at that point of time. If you did not, you'd have become a coward. So between cowardice and violence, I prefer violence. So, you know, the tipping point I'm making, so there are tipping points on which Gandhi changed his point of view radically. As I said, Gandhi became non-Gandhi. Gandhi became non-Gandhi. So friends, I think I'm coming to an end. I'm coming to an end, that the point I'm trying to make, that I give you foods for thought. I gave you an idea on the basis of my understanding of Gandhiji, but if I am able to provoke you to think further, to take it forward, I'll be very grateful. And thanks a lot for listening to me, and thanks a lot for giving me the idea that Gandhiji, the ideas of Gandhiji continue to remain relevant even today. And lastly, my request to all of you, this is a very bad time we are undergoing pandemic. Stay socially connected, but remain physically separate. Just for the sake of your survival, just for the sake of good life, and be happy and stay safe. God bless.
Thank you, sir.
Actually, I am really speechless. It's a nice, informative, illuminative, as well as thought-provoking session delivered by our Vice Chancellor, sir, who's supposed to be one of the members of our family, as he rightly noted. And say many things I have noted, but due to time constraint, let me make it open for questions. I have selected 2-3 questions, but time is so least. So let me ask, sir, one question, that do you think that India's independence is an outcome of negotiative endeavor by Gandhi? Yeah. Sir, first question is,
do you think that India's independence is an outcome of negotiative endeavor of Gandhi?
You know, the first of all, as you know, history cannot be seen in black and white. Your answer, I don't have a very specific answer to your question, but I would argue that India's independence was the outcome of many, what is called, big and small movements. And of course, Gandhi's non-violent movement, if you start from Champaran, till the 1942, it was Gandhiji who was prominent. But at the same time, there are other movements which subaltern historians are highlighting, which also led to India's independence. So I think, you know, I would argue that Gandhiji's role was prominent, but that doesn't mean the other fighters remain in the periphery.
Okay. So another question is that Gandhian philosophy, is Gandhian philosophy equally appropriate in today's times? Asked by Vinita Sarkar Bhoumik. Vinita Sarkar Bhoumik would like to seek answer from you. Is Gandhian philosophy equally appropriate in today's times?
You see, madam, your answer question, I think probably you know the answer better than me. I am not a Gandhian, but I appreciate Gandhian philosophy, because in this world of personal rivalry, in this world of mutual distrust, I think Gandhiji's ideas are little refreshing. And in that case, if we imbibe some of his ideas, probably it will be of help to us as human beings.
And so last question. Asked by one scholar, Joydeep Bhattacharya, he intend to know from you that you have elaborated G-A-N-D-H-I Gandhi. So he want to repeat it from you so that he will take a note. G-A-N-D-H-I Gandhi, you have elaborated. So,
you know, G for gentleness. G for gentleness, A for attentive. N for negotiating, D for diligent, hard working, H for humble, I for inquisitiveness, the desire to go more, inquisitiveness. This is how I see Gandhi.
Okay, so from the audience part.
Sir, can I ask a question? Am I audible to you?
Sir,
part of which you don't have is that the September will be released.
Hey, Papu. Hey, Papu. Prashna kora jabe na? Kibhabe kora jabe?
Very much.
Oh, it's a chat.
As I said, you have to understand Gandhi as a politician.
Unmuted.
No doubt about. When you talk of Badshah Khan and his politics, I mean, I don't know much about it, but still I can, whatever the thing which I read. You know, Badshah Khan did not face this kind of contradiction in the impacting star. Basically, a Muslim majority base. So Badshah Khan, you know, did not address this the way they got addressed in case of Bengal or in case of India, which Gandhi addressed. You know, don't forget the point I kept making, that as a politician, at that point of 1924, Gandhiji was keen to provide a strong resistance to the British. As a result, he took into account the idea of Caliph, Khilafat, idea of Khilafat. Now, merger of Khilafat and non-cooperation cannot be explained without referring to Gandhi being a strategist. It was a good strategy to bring Sayyid brothers from among the Muslims and the Hindus, you know, by reference to non-cooperation. So if you bring Hindus and Muslims together as separate entities, then probably it would be a strong resistance to the British. That is what Gandhi felt. But Tagore didn't believe in it. Tagore always argued that suppose you think of in this room, we're all together. We don't know our religion. We are having tea from the same cup. We are talking to each other with the same kind of intensity. Have I ever asked you what is your religion? So Tagore argued that the moment you stay together, you develop a common mindset. That's most important. Gandhiji probably didn't pay much attention to this. Gandhi had a problem. I'm not saying it's so easy. Otherwise, riot would not have taken place. But Tagore had a different point of view, because Tagore was talking about Birbhum and 50 villages. And Gandhi was talking about India as a whole. At that time, India was not as small as it is now.
Unmuted.
So, you know, the predicament or the difficulties which Gandhi faced was much more than what Tagore thought about. That's how it is.
Sir, may I ask a question to you? Am I audible to you, sir? Am I audible to you? Nimai, am I audible to? Okay, first of all, sir, am I audible to you? আপনি শুনতে পাচ্ছেন স্যার? নিমাই, নিমাই শোনা যাচ্ছে? নিমাই
আপনি বলুন।
আচ্ছা, আমার প্রথমত আই মাস্ট অ্যাডমিট দ্যাট ইট ইজ এ ভেরি অ্যাবসর্বিং এন্ড ইনসাইসিভ ডিসকাশন আই হ্যাভ বিন লিসেনিং। জাস্ট টু থিং আই উড লাইক টু নো ফ্রম হিম
এন্ড আই শুনতে পাচ্ছেন না
উনি। নিমাই আমি ও তাহলে
আপনি বলুন, আপনি বলুন।
হ্যাঁ, তুমি একটু কনভে করে দাও। আমার দুটো জিনিস, আমি দুটো জিনিস জাস্ট ওনাকে জাস্ট বলছি। এক নম্বর হচ্ছে দ্য পাওয়ার অফ লাভ হুইচ ইজ গ্রাজুয়ালি ডিমিনিশিং হি রেফার টু, হুইচ ইজ ভেরি ভেরি পার্টিনেন্ট অ্যান্ড ফ্যাসিনেটিং অবজারভেশন। ইনফ্যাক্ট আই থিঙ্ক দ্যাট ফ্রম দিস পয়েন্ট অফ ভিউ দ্য হোল আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ডিং অফ গান্ধীজি মে বি কনসেপচুয়ালাইজড, which is a very pertinent to me, it seems. And okay. secondly, I just want to point out he finally ended up by saying that Gandhiji in 1942 became very much changed his idea of non-violence and talked about violent and weapons, about all sorts of reference he made to. I just like to know whether he was influenced by the idea of Subhash, whether he was influenced by the idea of Subhash.
Okay.
These are the two humble submission to Professor Chakraborty. But I am personally very much enamored by this discussion. Thank you.
Sir, actually, this সন্দীপ, এটা হচ্ছে বাঙালিদের একটা প্রবলেম। বাঙালিরা সুভাষচন্দ্র বোস ছাড়া চলবে না। তো আমি যেটা বলি, এটা মানে একটু স্ট্রং কথাই বলি, বাংলাতেই বলছি, যে তিনজন লোক ভারতীয় হতে পারতো যারা ভারতীয় কখনো হলো না। একজনকেই বলি বালগঙ্গাধর তিলক, তিনি কখনো ভারতীয় হতে পারলে তিনি মারাঠি হয়ে রইলেন। আরেকজন হচ্ছে লালা লাজপত রায়, তিনি কখনো ভারতীয় হতে পারলেন না, পাঞ্জাবি হয়ে গেলেন। আরেকজন সুভাষচন্দ্র বোস, তিনি আইনে ফেজের আগে বাঙালি হয়ে গেলেন। আর গান্ধীজি একজন মানুষ যিনি ভারতীয় আমি মনে করি, একমাত্র হিন্দুস্তানি। এটা সম্বন্ধে তোমার সঙ্গে আমি ডিটেল আলোচনা করবো, লিখেওছি আমি এর উপরে। এটা যারা বাঙালি স্পেশালি নেতাজি ভক্ত, নেতাজি পুজো করেন যারা, তারা পছন্দ করবেন না। দেখো, আমি যেটা সবসময় বলি, যেটা বক্তব্যটা আমি বলেওছিলাম, যে গান্ধীজি হওয়ার পিছনে অনেকের ভূমিকা খুব গুরুত্বপূর্ণ। আমি দু তিনটে নাম করলাম, সব নামগুলো করতে পারলাম না। যেমন যেটাই বলেছি, যে গান্ধীজি হিউম্যানিজমটা অনেক ক্ষেত্রে এসছে রবীন্দ্রনাথের উপর। গান্ধীজি সাইন্টিফিক বেন্ট অফ মাইন্ডের যে লড়াইটা জানো, 1934 সালে যে বিহার আর্টকে লড়াইটা রবীন্দ্রনাথ ভার্সেস গান্ধি, সেটা থেকে প্রমাণ করা যায় যে গান্ধীর যে সাইন্টিফিক বেন্ট অফ মাইন্ডটা হয়তো বা রবীন্দ্রনাথ এটা ফেস করেছিলেন। বি আর আম্বেদকার সোশ্যাল জাস্টিস আইডিয়াটা করেছিলেন। কিন্তু সুভাষচন্দ্র বোসের যে বক্তব্যটা, যেটা ধরো সুভাষচন্দ্র বোসের ওপরে, যা তুমি জানো বোধ আমার প্রথম বইটাই সুভাষচন্দ্র বোসের ওপরেই, সেখানে আমি একটি দেখার চেষ্টা করেছিলাম যে সুভাষচন্দ্র বোস কিন্তু যে ভাবনা চিন্তাটা করেছিলেন সেটা সি আর দাসের ভাবনা চিন্তা। যদি সি আর দাস বেঁচে থাকতেন বিয়ন্ড 1925, তাহলে কিন্তু ভারতবর্ষের চিত্রটাই পাল্টে যেত। কিন্তু সেখানে সুভাষচন্দ্র বোস উড হ্যাভ প্লেড বিগার, মাচ বিগার রোল দ্যান হোয়াট ই ডিড লেটার। তবে এটা আমি সবসময় মনে করি যে গান্ধীজির সঙ্গে সুভাষবাবুর যে ধরনের লড়াই হয়েছে 1939 সালে, সেই লড়াইয়ের আগে পর্যন্ত গান্ধীজি কিন্তু সুভাষচন্দ্র বোসকে খুব পছন্দ করতেন অ্যাজ এ ইয়াং ব্রাইট ফায়ার ব্র্যান্ড লিডার ফ্রম বেঙ্গল। তো আমার ধারণা যে যে ইনফ্লুয়েন্সের কথা যেটা বলছো সেটা নিশ্চয়ই ছিল। এখন এক্স্যাক্টলি কি ইনফ্লুয়েন্স যদি তুমি জিজ্ঞেস করো সেটা বলতে পারবো না, কারণ তত ডিটেল গবেষণা আমি করিনি। তবে এটা ঠিক, 1939 সালে যে লড়াইটা আমরা দেখি, সে লড়াইটা কিন্তু হয় গান্ধীজি অ্যাজ এ পলিটিশিয়ান ভার্সেস সুভাষচন্দ্র অ্যাজ এ পলিটিশিয়ান। এটা খুব স্বাভাবিক, এই লড়াইটা আমাদেরকে সবসময় দেখি। কিন্তু আইডিওলজিক্যালি যদি তুমি গান্ধীর বক্তব্য দেখো 1938 সালে, যখন গান্ধীজি ওনাকে নমিনেট করছেন, তখন কিন্তু আমার ধারণা ইটস বেসড অন হিজ অ্যাপ্রিসিয়েশন অফ সুভাষচন্দ্র বিং আ ফায়ার ব্র্যান্ড বেঙ্গলের লিডার। আমি এইভাবেই জবাব দিতে পারবো, এক্স্যাক্ট জবাব আমার কাছে নেই, কারণ আমি ঠিক জানি না কোন কোন ক্ষেত্রে গান্ধীজি সুভাষবাবুর ভাবনা চিন্তাতে ইনফ্লুয়েন্সড হয়েছে। সঞ্জীব,
আমার
ওইটা কোথায় পাওয়া যায় সেই চার দিকে আসে যে নামগুলো?
নিমাই কিছু শোনা যাচ্ছে না?
হ্যাঁ